Speaker is Pablo Hurtado from the University of Granada. Let me tell you some words about Pablo. He did his degree and PhD in physics in Granada, in the University of Granada, under the supervision of Pedro Garrido in the group of Joaquín Marro, Miguel Muñoz, Pedro. Then he went to the States as a postdoc for 2 years, first to the Boston University, I think, to work with Sidney Reiner, no, Pablo?
Yes, that's right.
Then he moved to, again, as a postdoc to the University of Montpellier to work in the group of Berthier and Walter Cobb. And then I think in 2009, he got a Ramón y Cajal grant and came back to Spain to the University of Granada, to the Department of Electromagnetics and Physics of Matter. And nowadays he's an associate professor in this university. He works mainly in non-equilibrium statistical physics. He's an expert in this topic. And he's going to talk today about recent work he has published in Physical Review Letters about time crystals. Thank you, Pablo.
Okay. So, Cristóbal, thank you very much for this very kind introduction. First of all, thanks the organizers for inviting me to give this seminar. I feel like at home, surrounded by friends. So, so I'm going to talk today a little bit about rare events and how to use these events to engineer something called time crystal, continuous time crystals. This work has been done in collaboration. You can see my mouse. Is that right? My pointer? Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So this work has been done in collaboration with Rubén Hurtado and Carlos Pérez Espigares here at the University of Granada, and also together with Federico Carollo, who is now at Tübingen University in Germany. And you can find it published here. Okay, so this is the sketch, the outline of the talk. In particular, I will spend a bit of time talking about large deviations and large deviation functions, because I guess that not everyone here is familiar with these ideas. So I will spend, let's say, like half of the talk about talking about this large deviation theory, and then I will move on to describe our work on how to use these ideas to try to engineer these time crystals. Okay, so. First of all, a disclaimer. Probably if you have read or you have followed a little bit the literature about time crystals, there is a lot about quantum time crystals, and in particular quantum discrete time crystals. In this talk, there is no quantum physics. So H bar for me, it will be zero today. Maybe at least in the last slide, I will make H bar larger than zero, but I'm not sure if I will arrive in time. So we will live today in a purely classical stochastic world, okay? So the first thing I want to discuss is, what is this of large deviations and large deviation functions? No? So large deviation theory, as you see here, deals with exponential decay of probabilities in stochastic processes. No? So to be more concrete, it deals with how probability measure of a sample mean concentrates around the true average as the number of samples increases. Okay, so in order to better grasp these ideas, let me put a very simple example that I guess all of you know about, and is that of tossing and mythical fair coins. No, so we are going to toss n coins. We are going to assign a random variable b equals zero if we get tails, and b equal one if we get heads, and we consider that the coins are fair, so the probability of head or tails is just 1/2. And we ask about the probability of obtaining a given fraction of heads. With these definitions, the fraction of heads is this capital R, which depends on the number of samples, and it's just the average, the sample mean of these random variables, Vi. No? And the question I want to address is, what is the probability that this fraction of heads takes some given value for large n? No? As most or probably every one of you knows, This is we have a very good approximation that is given by the central limit theorem, which tell us that this distribution for large enough n number of samples will converge to a Gaussian with a given mean mu, which is just the mean of the underlying distribution for FDIs, and a given variance, which is the variance of the original distribution over the number of samples. No? So this is just a statement of the central limit theorem for this particular example. No? Okay, this is of course true, but something that we sometimes forget, and it's a big but, no? Is that this is a true statement, which is valid for fluctuations of R around the average, for let's say small fluctuations or fluctuations of the order of the variant of the standard deviation. No? So that means that R minus its average, which in this case is 1/2, will be of the order of 1/√(n) in this case, okay? So this is the regime of fluctuations where the central limit theorem statement is true. For this particular case, we can do better. Sorry, there's a question? No, okay. So let me keep going. So for this particularly simple example, we can do better. We can do the full computation. We can compute the exact probability of obtaining a given fraction of heads. As you may know, it's given by the binomial distribution, which is just this formula here. And for large enough n, we can use Stirling approximation, and we obtain the following scaling for this probability of the fraction of heads. No? So the probability of fraction of heads scale exponentially with n and some given function g of r here. We call this type of scaling a large deviation principle. And this scaling is telling us that this probability distribution is peaking around the average, which is 1/2. Here you have the plot as n increases in this exponential fashion. And this function g of r here is the tell us the rate at which this distribution is peaking around the average as n increases. So in large deviation theory, this function is called rate function or large deviation function, okay? For this particularly simple example, we can compute it. You can do just a Stirling approximation. Do this computation, and you obtain that this large deviation function is something like this that you have done here, which is essentially the mixing entropy, no? Which doesn't look like the quadratic polynomial that the central limit theorem predicts. No? So this is slightly more complex. In fact, this is the exact result. The central limit theorem is just the second order Taylor expansion, the quadratic expansion of this large deviation function around its minimum. So here you have this plot of the large deviation function. It's the blue curve here, and this dashed red line is the Gaussian or quadratic approximation, okay? So this g of r defines a large deviation function, our first large deviation function. And something you can read from this plot is that if you move away from the average 1/2 and you go to the tails of the distribution, the fact that this g of r, as it is defined here, is larger than the Gaussian approximation is telling us that very rare fluctuations of this parameter r are far more probable than predicted within the central limit theorem approximation, okay? So just let's keep in mind these ideas. So this is the definition of a large deviation function. And okay, so we are gonna look for large deviation functions in statistical physics. So you would ask, why do we care about large deviation functions in statistical physics? Well, so large deviation theory is essentially the mathematical language of StatMech. You can see it when you study equilibrium statistical mechanics, for instance, the microcanonical ensemble, then you realize that the partition function, in this case, the number of microstates compatible with a given macrostate scales in a large deviation form in this way. And in this case, this small s is the entropy per particle, and this is nothing but the large deviation function associated to this partition function. if you do the same for the canonical ensemble, then you realize that, again, the partition function scales in a large deviation form with a number of particles, and the large deviation function is nothing but the Helmholtz free energy density. No? In this way, you realize that really, I mean, large deviation theory is the language, a mathematical language in which StatMech is correctly formulated. You can realize then that the equilibrium states are the one which extremize the associated large deviation function. In the case of a microcanonical ensemble, the equilibrium macrostate is the one maximizing entropy. Or in the case of the canonical ensemble, the equilibrium macrostate is the one minimizing the free energy. In fact, the Legendre duality, typical of thermodynamics, is easily understood within this framework once you realize that the different partition functions are related via Laplace transform plus this large deviation scaling. No? As soon as you have this large deviation scaling and you send n to infinity, this Legendre duality between the different large deviation functions becomes apparent. No? Okay, so this is all very well known. There is nothing new here. The main message here I want to send is that in equilibrium, thermodynamic potentials are large deviation functions. Why so much noise during the last years about this large deviation theory? Well, as you may know, we do not know how to write down something like non-equilibrium thermodynamic potentials, no? So thermodynamic potentials out of equilibrium. We don't know how to write partition functions. We don't know how to write the stationary measure in a non-equilibrium steady state. Not to mention, we don't know how to define even non-equilibrium thermodynamic potentials, but we do know how to define large deviation functions out of equilibrium. And the hope is that these large deviation functions out of equilibrium may play the role of the equilibrium thermodynamic potentials, but out of equilibrium. You can study this type of interesting physics in transport phenomena, glassy system, amorphous materials, or even in open quantum systems. Today, I will focus on large deviation theory in transport phenomena. However, there is a catch, and is that while in equilibrium, we really have to consider the probability of a given microstate, a given configuration, no? in phase space, as soon as we go out of equilibrium, time matters. And this is true even when we are in a non-equilibrium steady state. So even in a steady state, if it's non-equilibrium, time matters. We have strong spatiotemporal correlations. And that essentially this means that in order to do large deviations in non-equilibrium, we have to consider not points in phase space, but trajectories. So we are gonna consider the statistics of trajectories out of equilibrium. Okay, so in order to better set the stage of this problem, let me talk about the typical setting that we are going to study. No? So this is like the icing model of this non-equilibrium large deviation theory. No? So let's consider the following problem. We have the quasi one-dimensional channel of length L connecting two particle reservoirs at one the left high density and the other one at low density. As you may know, essentially, as time goes on, we will find a particle current flowing from the high density reservoir to the low density reservoir. And eventually the system will reach a steady state with a density profile, which might be non-trivial, and a current, which in the steady state is given by Fick's law, which tells us that it's essentially proportional to the density gradient, okay? Now we're gonna do the following experiment. We are gonna count how many particles travel to the right minus the particles traveling to the left. We are gonna call this observable capital Q of T. We are gonna do that for a long but finite time T. And this is something like the cumulative current. No? We follow the time evolution of this cumulative current, we will see something like this. No? So we will see some observable, which is essentially growing linearly with time, but with some fluctuations, unavoidable fluctuations, which has to do with the microscopic, chaotic or stochastic nature of the dynamics. No? However, if we consider the average current, that is the cumulative current over the time t, the average current per unit time, we will see that this current per unit time converge as time goes on to a well-defined value that for very long times goes to the ensemble average, which is given by fixed law, as I told you before. If we repeat this experiment many times, we will see something like this. No? So these are many realizations of this cumulative current up to a time capital T, long enough but finite. Of course, if we consider the current per unit time, it will converge as time goes on to this ensemble average. But for a big, for a large but finite T, we will see a fluctuation of this average current. In fact, we can plot this the probability of a current fluctuation, and we will see something like that, a Gaussian or a bell-shaped distribution with a peak around the ensemble average current. No? And these blue different trajectories will correspond to standard fluctuations around this average. No? So small fluctuations around the average. But if we repeat many, many, many times this experiment, eventually, we will arrive at realizations like these ones. So these realizations tell us that for a long but finite time t, we are observing a cumulative current which is not traveling from the high density to the low density reservoir, but the reverse. So we have trajectories where for a long time t, there is a net current flowing from the low density reservoir to the high density reservoir. As opposed to what most people believe, there is nothing wrong with these trajectories, no? Because here time is long but finite. Okay, eventually, if we keep going, these trajectories will go up. Essentially, at the very end, all of them will converge to average to the average current. Okay, so these rare trajectories populate the tails of this distribution. Okay. So we can consider the probability of this current, and you can prove that this probability scales in a large deviation form in this way, where now here enters our extensive parameter is not only the system size, but also the time. This scaling is again a large deviation principle and defines the current large deviation function, okay? So this is going to be the object of our study, no? The current large deviation function in a few models of transport. I will try to convince you that this current large deviation function has interesting physics. Okay, the hope is that this current large deviation function will play a role akin to these thermodynamic potentials out of equilibrium. And I want to show you today that the tails of this current large deviation function contain a very interesting physics. In order to do so, let me first introduce the model I'm going to work today. This model is a very, very simple model of particle transport in one dimension. It's called the weakly asymmetric simple exclusion process, or in short, WASEP, no? WASEP. It is just a one-dimensional lattice with L sides and capital M particles. In each side, there is at most one particle, so we can define occupation numbers at each side, which can be or zero or one, but not two. So there is no multiple occupancy. Particles can jump to neighboring empty sites at rates R plus minus given by this formula here, where you see there is this capital E, which is something like an external field, which is biasing the jumps, let's say, if it's positive to the right, okay? We need this scaling L here with the system size in order to make the external field compete with diffusion in the hydrodynamic limit, okay? We can define this model both with open boundary conditions, so coupled to particle reservoirs at the boundaries, or in a one-dimensional ring. You can go to two dimensions, three dimensions, you can do many things, but today I'm gonna focus on very simple one-dimensional model. Okay, so we have particles which jump stochastically, to the right or to the left. There is some external field biasing diffusion towards one side, and most importantly, we have exclusion. So particles cannot overcome each other. So there is no interaction, but as soon as you don't see any particle, but as soon as you have one neighboring particle, you cannot overcome this particle. So this is the only interaction we have in the model. So very, very simple, boring model, you would say. At the mesoscopic level, you can study, the hydrodynamic scaling limit of this model. You can define a density field rho of x and t of a given position at a given time. And this density field evolves in time according to this Langevin equation, which is nothing but a diffusion equation, okay? Here you have this is just the fluctuating current in terms of the density and the current. This is nothing but a continuity equation. No? The number of particles are conserved. So if something changes here, it's because it's moving somewhere else. No? So for the YSEP, the diffusion coefficient and the mobility coefficient are given by these two numbers. It's the diffusivity is constant, and the mobility is just rho times 1 minus rho. And this X here is just some Gaussian white noise of zero average and variance one. Okay, so once we're in this mesoscopic level, we can apply path integral formalism to write down the probability of a given path in this mesoscopic phase space. So we can write down the probability of a given history of the density and the current field for a time from the origin time up to time tau. And this probability scales again in a large division function with this action capital I, which is given by this functional here, okay? Which involves both an integral or a space and time of the current. And this is essentially the controlled by the transport coefficients. So once we have the probability of a path in mesoscopic phase space, we can start asking questions. No? What's the probability of a given time average current? No? So you can solve for this particularly simple model, you can solve this problem, and you find that the probability of a given time average current, again, obeys this large division principle, where this G of Q is the current large division function, which can be exactly written in this way. So it's this large division function is the solution of a variational problem involving this axiom, subject to some constraints, in particular that the time average current has to be equal to this number Q. No? So the time average of this current field has to be Q, okay? So if you look carefully at this variational problem, the solution will give you, of course, the large division function plus some very interesting information, the typical path associated to a given Q, okay? So this will tell you what's the probability of a current fluctuation and the typical path the system follows in this mesoscopic phase space in order to sustain such a current fluctuation. And it's here in the physics of these paths where very interesting physics happen. In particular, we find something that we call dynamical phase transitions. No? When you condition the current to be far away from the average behavior, you find very interesting behavior. In particular, we find different types of dynamical phases or different types of trajectories which dominate different types of current fluctuations. These changes involve emergent order, collective rearrangement, and spontaneous symmetry breaking. In particular, for this WASEP model, we find something like this. So let me explain you a little bit. So here you have a raster plot of the time evolution of the WASEP. So red dots are particles. This x-axis is space. Y-axis is time. This is the typical evolution in the steady state. Okay, so there is some external field. The average current is just sigma E. So there's a net current of particles flowing to the right in this plot, even though from an average point of view, there's nothing ongoing in here. No? So if you compute the average density here in this case is just a flat profile with density constant and equal to the average density rho zero. Okay, what if we ask what's the probability of a current well below the average current? So we find trajectories associated to these very small currents which look like something like this. No? So if you ask the system to sustain a very small current, well below this average current, the system suddenly decided to jam all particles in a density wave and make this density wave travel around the system, okay? So this is again the same raster plot where you see that particles are stacked together, they form a jam, and this jam is moving ballistically in time, no? So remember we have periodic boundary conditions, so when the density wave exits this way, enters in this other side, okay? So this is a well-defined density wave. What is going on here? So because you are asking the system to sustain a very, very small current, even though it's natural, steady state current, it's this one, how can the system manage to do that in the best way? So, okay, let's form a jam. In fact, you find that there's a critical current below which this happens. You can compute the large deletion function, and you find that associated to this change of behavior, there is a singularity, second order type phase transition in the large deletion function, where you have for currents around Q equals zero, you have this regime where this traveling wave dominates the typical path associated to a given current fluctuation, okay? So, I mean, we knew this already for some time now, but if you look at this with care, I mean, you realize that this is something very similar to what people in other areas are calling a time crystal, okay? So that's the question, no, that we are gonna address today. This is not exclusive of WASEP. These dynamical phase transitions abound in the fluctuations of many body systems. Let me give you a partial and of course 100% biased list of examples. You can find dynamical phase transitions in energy diffusion models in one dimension, but you can also see dynamical phase transition in two-dimensional transport models like two-dimensional WASEP. Also in open systems, in this case, there are no traveling waves, but icing type phase transitions involving up-down symmetry breaking in the open WASEP. But people also has found dynamical phase transitions in glasses and amorphous materials. In fact, I'm pretty strong, I would say, ongoing proposal is that the very well-known glass transition is in fact due to an underlying dynamical phase transition in the activity of disorder systems. You have here this paper by Chandler et al. In Science in 2009, and there are many other papers which support strongly this picture of the glass transition. And again, this is not only restricted to classical system, but also there are dynamical phase transition in quantum system, open quantum system, and in particular related to symmetries in quantum systems, okay? So, okay, so coming back to the question, is this a time crystal? Okay, so we have something which is time periodic, okay? So for that, we have to go back to the literature and see how people define what a time crystal is. And people define time crystal by analogy with spatial, with standard crystal, or what it's better known as a spatial crystal. So what is a spatial crystal, according to, for instance, Vilcek in this paper in 2019, no? So in a standard crystal, we have a periodic structure in a space. So when we lower temperature, the fluid, which is invariant under continuous spatial translation, breaks the symmetry, breaks spontaneously, and that's important, this symmetry, and it becomes less symmetric because it just becomes symmetric for discrete space translations, which has to do with the spatial scaling of the underlying lattice in the crystal. Okay, so by analogy, we expect that in a time crystal, we will have some time periodicity, not spatial, but time periodicity. And we expect that our system, that in some phase should exhibit continuous time translation symmetry, in some other phase will break this continuous time translation symmetry and will exhibit discrete time translation symmetry. So according to these terms, and just intuitively, our jam density wave moving in this one-dimensional wasp looks like a time crystal. No? So we have this density wave, which is moving with some given velocity along the line, and it looks like very much like a time crystal. So in order to check with more care this, we studied the spectral signatures of the dynamical phase transition to see whether at the spectral level, the time crystal phase, I mean, the traveling wave phase is, looks like a time crystal. So for that, let me introduce the microscopic dynamics of WASEP. So at the microscopic level, the dynamics of our system is controlled by a master equation like this one, where P of C and T is the probability of a given configuration C at time T, which again evolves according to this master equation, where this capital W is just a transition rate, no, transition probability, and this capital R is just the exit rate for a given configuration. No? So the sum over all possible exit configurations of the probability of going from C to C prime. No, we can formulate this very same equation using the quantum Hamiltonian formalism. These probabilities can be encoded in a Hilbert space, defining some given probability vector, which contains all the physics, all the information about our system at time t. And using this quantum Hamiltonian formalism, we see, I mean, one can easily see that the probability, this vector in Hilbert space evolves according to this master equation, where this probability vector is just the sum over C of the probabilities of C over T times the Hilbert vector corresponding to a given configuration C. This capital W is just an operator working in this Hilbert space and takes this form in terms of the projectors over C and C prime. And you should notice that the steady state for this problem is given by the null eigenvectors, the null eigenvalue and the null eigenvector of this Markov generator. So this equation here defines the steady state, and one should always recall that these probabilities are normalized, and this implies this normalization condition on the generator W. For those here expert in stochastic processes, this is the same as saying that each row has to have zero sum in the Markov generator, which is the standard requirement. Okay, so for the particular case of WASEP that we study here, these vectors in the Hilbert space for a given configuration C are given by this exterior product, where nk is the occupation number at site k. Okay, so remember we have particles in a lattice. And the generator is written in this way in terms of raising and lowering Pauli operators. No? So it's relatively easy to understand this generator. So here we have jumps to the right. So we destroy a particle in K and create one particle in K plus one at a rate R plus. Here we have jumps to the left, destroy particles in K plus one, create it in K at rate R minus, and here we have a term which implies, which is given by the conservation of probability, okay? So why I do this? Because we can now study large deviations from this microscopic point of view using generalization of the master equation. So for that, we are gonna study an ensemble of trajectories conditioned on a given current Q. So as I told you before, the probability of a given current Q after a time T scales in a large deviation form in this way. This is the current large deviation function. Working, this Q is something like a global constraint, no? It's like working in the microcanonical ensemble, no? Where we constrain all configurations to have a given fixed energy, no? As you know, working with global constraints is not particularly easy. It's better to work, to change ensemble and work with the Lagrange multiplier. We fix the average value of the constraint. So we do the same trick here, And we define a dynamical partition function, which is nothing but the Laplace transform of this probability. This dynamical partition function is this CT of lambda. And you can prove that this dynamical partition function scales, again, in a large deviation form, where this theta of lambda is the large deviation function, and it's just the Legendre transform of the current large deviation function. This theta of lambda is called a dynamical free energy in this setting, okay? So how can we compute this theta of lambda? Well, when you do the microscopic analysis of fluctuations in starting from your master equation, then you realize that this theta of lambda, this dynamical free energy, is nothing but the largest eigenvalue of a tilted generator. So you can obtain this biased generator, tilted generator, this W of lambda, which is essentially equal to W, but with this you see here, this bias here, which is this lambda is biasing jumps and direction. For instance, for lambda positive, this lambda is biasing the dynamics for jumps to the right. So essentially, it's making positive currents more likely. Okay, so we use lambda to bias the dynamics for positive currents or negative currents as compared to the average. Okay, so this dynamical free energy is nothing but the largest eigenvalue of this operator, of this bias generator. Okay. So this largest eigenvalue is called theta zero, okay? Of course, you have to define the spectral problem for this bias generator. You have to define the right eigenvectors, the left eigenvectors. This is the spectrum. And you can define all the probabilities of a given current fluctuations in terms of this bias ensemble. Okay, so let's have a look at the spectrum of this bias generator for the WASP, okay? In particular, we are going to look at the spectrum of the bias generator, both in the phase where nothing interesting is going on, in the flat phase, so to say, and when the traveling wave merges. Okay. And the end story is that the spectrum changes radically as we move from the boring phase to the traveling wave phase. So this is the spectrum or the leading eigenvalues of the bias generator. This, the y-axis is the imaginary part of the spectrum. The x-axis is the real part. And these yellow dots are the leading eigenvalues, the first L eigenvalues of the generator, okay? These gray dots, these big dots are for a big L, I don't know, 24 sites. And the gray dots tell us how the leading eigenvalues evolve as L increases, okay? So what conclusions can we draw from this plot? So first of all, we see that the spectrum is gapped for standard currents or for a small current fluctuation. So there is a clear gap in the spectrum. Here in this plot down here, we plot the real part as a function of the inverse system size, and the imaginary part, sorry, as a function of the inverse system size. So what you see again is that even as L goes to infinity or as L increases, there is a clear gap in the spectrum. So this means that there's a unique steady state, and essentially this steady state is boring in the sense that it's just flat. It has continuous time translation symmetry. Let's look at the spectrum as we move on to the Tramley wave phase. So now we move lambda to some critical regime such that the associated current is below this critical current that I was describing before. No? So in this regime of lambda, the typical path in phase space is this one. So we have a Tramley wave, and let's look at the spectrum in this case. So it looks radically different. So here you have again the leading eigenvalues. You have its evolution with L. And what you see is that if you plot the real part as a function of 1 over L, you see a clear gap closing convergence as L goes to infinity. Of course, we cannot reach a thermodynamic limit, but you can really see the tendency. All leading eigenvalues, their real parts keeps closing as L increases as a power law. And in principle, they seem to go to zero in the thermodynamic limit. Okay, so we have a vanishing spectral gap. And what is also interesting is that the imaginary parts of these leading eigenvalues develop a very well-defined band structure as L increases with a well-defined frequency spacing delta. And this immediately implies that in this trend we face, from this spectral point of view, we expect a time periodic steady state with a period which is given essentially by the inverse of this of this gap, and this gap can be related with the velocity of the traveling wave. So when you read the literature of time crystalline, you realize that these are the spectral signatures, the clear spectral signatures of time crystals. So what I want to say here is that we have, I mean, this very simple model, WASEP, has a time crystal phase in the fluctuation tails of the current distribution, okay? But of course, the question is, who cares about this? Why do we care if this beautiful physics lives down there in the tails of the current distribution? If you keep looking at your system, you can wait the age of the universe and probably you will never see something like this going on. If you see it, then you will see this traveling wave. But the probability is so low that most likely you will never see. Well, the funny thing is that you can implement some mathematical trick to make these rare events typical, okay? So this is the idea now. So we know that we have a time crystal phase in the tail of the current distribution, and now we want to make this rare event of the WASEP. We want to look for a model which has this traveling wave phase as its average steady state behavior. Okay, so let's generate trajectories with W lambda. You will say that let's employ this generator. This is the generator of this system. But the problem is that this generator is very interesting, but it's non-physical. It does not conserve probability. If you remember the condition before, I mean, it has no zero row, zero sum row condition, okay? But here comes in our rescue mathematical trick called Doob's transform, which allow, it's just a similarity transformation of the tilted or deformed operator, generator. And it's defined in this way, where this L zero is some diagonal matrix where with the elements of the leading left eigenvectors in the diagonal. I mean, the details really doesn't matter here now. The funny thing is that this is well studied now in the large aviation literature for a few years. The funny thing is that this Doob's generator is now a well-defined physical generator. So it's the generator of a physical system. So it conserves probability. And what is most interesting, it has the same spectral properties as the original generator. So if we have a time crystal phase in this generator, then with this Doob's transform trick, we will be able to obtain a physical system which exhibits in its steady state a time crystal phase. And this is the idea that we explore here. Okay, so you can write down the spectrum for this Doob operator. It's, as I told you before, is related to the spectrum of the original bias generator. And what is this trick is doing is essentially shifting the distribution. So here you have the original current distribution. The funny behavior is happening down here in the tail. And with the Doob's transform, we get a system which has a current distribution which looks like this. So it has the peak essentially on top of the interesting behavior we want to address, okay? Of course, there must be some problem, no? So nothing can be so easy. And the problem, of course, is that this Doob generator is highly non-trivial and complex. So as soon as you do this Doob transform, the new generator involves all sorts of non-local, long-range interactions and things, no? So the last thing I want to do is to analyze in physical terms what's the how this Doob generator looks like, okay? So for that, what I'm gonna do is to break down the Doob generator in terms of the original WASEP dynamics supplemented by an external field that I call E lambda Doobs, okay? So what this trick is doing is just encoding all this complex physics in an external field. So you can see this external field as the external field I should apply on my WASEP model in order to make this Trolley wave appear in the stationary state. Again, this external field is highly complex, non-local, and all type of complexities you can think of are encoded in this Doob field. Okay, if you do this mapping, then you can write down a formula for this Doob field, and you arrive to this expression here, which essentially depends on this logarithm of this fraction here, where you have the projection of configurations. I mean, the Doob field for the transition from configuration C to C prime depends on this fraction, which is the projection of each configurations on the leading left eigenvalue. Okay, so something really, in principle, very complex. So what we did is to analyze what's behind this Doob field at the physical level. So for that, we analyze how this Doob field depends on the typical, on the order parameter of the transition for this Trolley wave. As you can imagine, when the Trolley wave appears, so let me go, sorry. So how to distinguish the flat regime where nothing happens from this Trolley wave regime where this density wave, which is moving around. So we need to define some order parameter which is able to identify packing, okay? So when particles are packed, we want something that takes a value close to one. And when particles are spread in our ring, we want something which takes values close to zero. And then you can easily imagine that this order parameter or this packing order parameter can be given in terms of the modulus of the first mode of the Fourier transform of the density field. Okay, so in other literature, this is called the Kuramoto order parameter. Okay, so you take this order parameter and its modulus will be large if we have packing and will be small if we don't have packing. Here you have an example. If we have the particles well packed, this RC will be big enough. We'll have a value close to one. What is more important, the phase of this C, okay, this phase will be the angular position of the center of mass of the pack of the density wave. Okay, so the phase is giving us the center of mass position, and RC is telling us how well packed particles are. No? So we are going to study this Doob field in terms of this packing order parameter. So we did that, and we find a very interesting and surprising behavior. This Doob field can be, in principle, very complex, but when you analyze it in terms of the packing order parameter, then you realize, for instance, that these projections are a very well-defined function of the packing order parameter in such a way that if configuration C has particle very, very well packed, then this projection will be high. And if configuration C is such that particles are spread all over the ring, then this projection will be low. So you see that there is a very strong correlation. This allows us to assume, and this is just an empirical hypothesis, that these projections are just function of this packing order parameter. This is a huge simplification, okay? We have many, many different configurations, but this number here is just a number and it goes from 0 to 1. So this is a huge configuration. This function here is this function here. It can be complex, it really doesn't matter. Another interesting issue is that C and C prime are two linked configurations. And two linked configurations differ in just one particle. One particle jumps from here to there, okay? So they are very close. The packing order parameter for two connected configurations is very similar, okay? So this projection here over this projection here, I mean, you can do, it's the RC prime over RC
is just a perturbation, and you can do an expansion and keep it at first order. And then you realize that this complex Doob field takes this very simple form under these assumptions. No? Okay, in principle, it doesn't look like much simpler than before, but it is in fact much simpler. So let's have a look at what this Doob field is doing. So we have some constant term, and we have, look here, we have a sinus of the angular position of the K side minus the angular position of the center of mass. And this is this sinus is weighted by the packing order parameter. So if we plot this, what we call this a packing field, it has this shape, okay? It is a sinus center around the angular center of mass of the, okay. So it's a sinus center around the packing, around the density wave center of mass. Well, so what is this packing field doing? So this packing field, it's very easy to understand, is just pushing particles which are behind the center of mass, while at the same time is restraining particles which are moving ahead. So this field here is packing particles around the center of mass position of the density wave, okay? And the amplitude of this packing field is proportional to the packing order parameter in such a way that when we have a well-defined pack, this packing field will be very strong. And when the configurations are spread, this packing field will be small. Okay, so this packing field is amplifying naturally occurring fluctuations of the packing order parameter. Okay, so we have particles all spread around the ring. This particle which will move randomly. This random motion will give rise to small fluctuations of the packing order parameter. And if we supplement the constant field with this packing external field, for large enough lambda, where lambda, you have to recall, is the driving field, no? We will have eventually that this packing field manages to pack all particles in a density wave and make it travel around the system. No? So this packing field is pushing particles around the angular center of mass. Okay, so this is like the physics behind the dynamical phase transition in the WASET. So how can we use this to engineer a lattice gas with a time crystal phase? So, okay, so let's use this insight to propose exactly that, a time crystal lattice gas. So this lattice gas is essentially inspired by this packing field and is just a variant of the WASET with a configuration dependent packing field. Okay, so we have particles again in a ring which can jump to the empty neighboring sides, to the left, to the right, and to the left. And these particles are subject to this external packing field. We have a constant term, which is pushing particles, let's say, to the right or in clockwise or anti-clockwise direction. And then we have this packing term, which is pushing particles behind the center of mass and is dragging particles in front of the center of mass with an amplitude proportional to lambda and to the packing order parameter. These are the jump rates. What we did is just to make simulations, Monte Carlo simulations of this time crystal lattice gas. In this case, we are not talking about fluctuations. We are gonna focus on the standard steady state behavior of this model, okay? This is what we found. To make a long story short, what we found is a very well-defined putative second-order phase transition to a time-crystalline phase as we increase this lambda parameter, which now is just an external parameter. No, this is the packing parameter. No? So here in this plot, you have the top left panel. You have the order parameter of the transition, the average packing or the parameter as a function of lambda. What you see is that, lambda is negative in this case. As you increase the absolute value of lambda, you have one phase where you have just the flat configuration, no packing, just nothing going on, constant density field. And for large enough packing amplitude, you have a second order phase transition to a phase with a well-defined packing. You, here you have the different system sizes. We studied also the fluctuations of the packing order parameter, something like the susceptibility of the order parameter, and you see a clear divergency around the critical point as the system size increases. And you can also study the Binder cumulant, this U4, which is in this middle inset, and you can identify nicely the critical lambda, the critical driving field at which the phase transition happened. You can do an hydrodynamic analysis of the of this transition. This is the hydrodynamic limit of this model. You have again a diffusion equation with this packing field at the field theoretic level. You can do a local stability analysis to look for this, this critical line. And the dashed lines in this plot are the theoretical predictions. And as you see, everything agrees neatly, okay? We can study also the density at a given point. If we have a time crystal, we expect the density at a given point to oscillate in time. And this oscillation, as we go to the thermodynamic limit, should be reversed and do not decay in time. So this is what you have here in this top right panel. You have periodic density oscillations at a given point. These density oscillations have a are damped, so they decay with time. But as the system size grows, this damping rate, which is in this middle inset, decays to zero. And this is telling you that this, this periodic phase is robust and really lives in the thermodynamic limit. No? We can also compute the density profiles and compare them with the theory, and everything agrees nicely. No? Okay, so I would say that, yes, we have a time crystal phase. No? So just to end the talk, let me ask what if, no? So we have seen that, what is this packing field doing? It's just, okay, it's packing particles around the instantaneous center of mass. But if you see it from a Fourier point of view, it's something like exciting the first mode of the Fourier spectrum, no? What if, instead of exciting the first mode, we excite any mode, okay? So you can generalize this idea of the time crystal lattice guys and define a generalized order parameter where this n is, it's essentially giving you the mode n. For in the previous case, this n was equal one. So now we are gonna excite the mode n with this packing field, which again, is proportional to the absolute value of this, this set n and has a sinus of the argument minus n phi. What if we excite the n mode? So what we see, and this is this is work in progress, we're about to publish these results. So what we see is that we obtain a multimode time, multimode and controllable continuous time crystal phase. So we can really engineer phases, rotating phases in the thermodynamic limit with as many modes as we want and with the given velocities and so on. So let me show you just to finish a small video where you can see how if you decide the second mode, then you have a time crystal with two density waves. But now if we excite the third mode, we have a time crystal with three waves. And we will do the same with five modes, and then we have a time crystal with five modes. So this is really giving us a mechanism to really work work with and engineer this time crystalline phase in the classical case. So this is the summary of the talk. Hopefully I've convinced you that this simple idea allows you to build a time crystal phase for simple diffusive systems. The idea now is first how to, I mean, explore this idea to really see how to control this system. And second, can we go to the quantum realm? We believe we can go, so we can make H bar different from zero, and we will have the same mechanism working in open quantum systems. So, but this is just for the future. So thank you very much for your attention, and let me also thank my co-authors Carlos, Ruben, and Federico for their work in this paper. Okay, so thank you.
Okay, thank you, Pablo, for the very nice talk. Are there questions?
Yeah, I have one question.
Okay.
Yes, please.
It's about Hamiltonian of the WhatsApp situation. I wonder, is it really symmetric to continuous time translation? Is it true? Because it seems that the force there is not conservative force. So I mean, the line integral for the closed loop is not zero. So for me, I imagine the realization by like a Faraday's law, like electric field generation by magnetic field increasing in time through the loop. So I imagine like if we write down the Hamiltonian explicitly, can it be the form of the time translation symmetric form? That's my question.
Well, I think you cannot push too far the quantum Hamiltonian formalism. You can try to define a Hamiltonian, but this Hamiltonian, for instance, will be non-Hermitian, no? So I mean, this is, of course, not a conservative system. It's an open system, a stochastic dynamics. So from that point of view, even though you can try to write down, I mean, the Hamiltonian, but it's not a proper Hamiltonian in some sense, okay?
Ah, okay. It's a kind of effective Hamiltonian for open system.
So something like that. People talk now about non-Hermitian Hamiltonians, and this is very much related to this type of formalism. No?
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. No questions?
Yes. Hello.
Yes.
I have some doubts with the simple WhatsApp process.
Yes.
You had these rare fluctuations with the coherent structures, but yes. I didn't know if it's clear that it's a rare fluctuation to have this kind of structures, but what is the survival time of it? Like once you have it, it gets destroyed or it perdures in time.
I mean, the question is rather the reverse, no? If you fix the time, and then you ask, you fix a time, and you fix
the current.
And then you ask, what's the probability for that time and that current, and the probability and the typical path that takes you there, no? But of course, if you start from this initial condition, this is from the steady state typical dynamics, this initial condition is unstable, no? So it will quickly decay. I mean, imagine WhatsApp is just pure diffusion, no? So if you start with this pack, it will quickly diffuse to the flat steady state.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
You have to think in terms of constraint dynamics, no? So if you constrain your trajectories to have a given current, then these are the typical trajectories that will dominate the path to the fluctuation for currents below this critical current.
Okay, yeah. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Questions?
I have one question. Hi, Pablo. This is Raul.
Hola, Raul. Hi.
Hola. Hi. It's about the critical behavior. There's two questions. One, I think you probably know the answer is, of course, you have all these critical behavior, and then you can define all critical exponents using finite size scaling. Probably you have done that, right? And compute the exponents.
We are doing that. Okay.
And then, don't move from there. That's
the sorry.
I want to show. No, that's okay. Because the second thing is related to that one. Is that you have this analogy, you have this critical behavior described by the zeros of this, by the spectrum of the operator, okay?
Yes.
And this seems very similar to the Yang and Lee theory of phase transitions.
Yes.
That brings, and then in there, you can also obtain the critical exponents by the way these zeros approach the
We haven't done that, but I know people is doing that in dynamical phase transition. In fact, I'm thinking of there's some guy called Flint. You know his name?
No.
Pecola, and Yuka Pecola, I think.
Okay, yes.
Flint, they are doing essentially the Li-Yang picture of the series of the dynamical partition function. And they are related, in fact, to dynamical phase transition. And you can obtain the scaling, I mean, the universality class from the scaling of these zeros in the complex plane.
Right, correct. Okay. So yes, this has been done.
Well, I'm not sure for this particular case, but for some other dynamical phase transitions, it has been, or it's being done, yes. I think there are a couple of PRL papers in the last, I don't know, 3-4 years about this.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, thank you.
We have a couple of questions.
Hi.
Well, first, can we talk this effective, this smart field or this dots field, something like a Maxwell demo? It's a field that adapts to the configuration to keep it concentrated. Is this a physical realization of a Maxwell demo?
Yes, in fact, two things. First, if you want to do this experimentally, which is one question we were wondering about, how to do this in an experiment. No, we were trying to convince experimentalists to do this. And essentially, you need some CCD camera which detects where the colloids are, because this is essentially a colloidal fluid in a one-dimensional trap. No, and you need a CCD camera which detects where the instantaneous center of mass is to pack particles around that point. So in that sense, it's something like there's some Maxwell daemon which is looking at your system and allowing particles to go or not go depending on their energy. You know, but if you analyze with some care this packing field, then you realize that instead of writing it in terms of phi k minus the phi of the center of mass, you can write it down exactly equal to a Kuramoto-like interaction. So then you can forget about something external doing something on your system, but you have to pay the price that all particles in your ring are seeing all other particles in the ring via a Kuramoto-like interaction. Okay, this is not Kuramoto, exactly Kuramoto, in the sense of the particles on the ring, because we have exclusion, okay? When you plot the Kuramoto oscillators and you plot the phase of each oscillator in the one dimension and the unit circle, then you can see something like our model, no? Particles which are moving around, but this oscillator can overcome each other, which does not happen here.
Okay, this goes to my next question. First, a comment on nomenclature. I mean, you call this a time crystal, and for me it's okay, but in fact, I think it's nothing more than a traveling wave. I mean, it's a fancy name for a traveling wave.
Yes, I would say yes. Right? There is a lot of fight about what a time crystal is and what it is not, and it's very fancy. Yes. I agree.
I'm always surprising more in the quantum realm. People call time crystal to something that has been always called in the superharmonic response in
systems.
Okay, but I think there is a distinctive, both in the quantum and the classical examples of time crystals, there is the fact that those structures survive fluctuations in the thermodynamic limit. And so they are traveling waves, but that exist in the presence of fluctuations.
Yeah, they are robust.
Yeah, they are. That's interesting. But I wonder if if it happens as in usual phase transitions, that the interactions are relevant for doing that. For example, what happens in these diffusive systems if you remove the exclusion?
Okay. We are discussing exactly that now. I believe, and this is just a belief today, that this behavior will survive. In fact, if you remove the exclusion, then you have essentially Kuramoto. I mean, our particles moving in a ring without exclusion, is like a discretized version of the Kuramoto, of the phase of each Kuramoto oscillator moving in the circle. And Kuramoto has synchronization, then I expect my particles subject to the packing field will exhibit a time crystal phase transition.
So even in the absence of any interactions between the particles.
But
or this global or this Kuramoto-like interaction.
Yeah, but remember that the packing field is essentially an interaction, all-to-all interaction, okay?
Okay, good, thanks.
And also the other question is also interesting. How real interactions between particles do affect the time crystal structure? So we are also working in this direction now.
Okay. More questions? I have one question, Pablo.
Go ahead, please, Pera.
Hi, Pablo.
This was remarked. In fact, I was going to ask before, what happens if instead of excursion, you have long range interaction in the original model, not in the packing thing that you put there to I mean, the point is you have an original model that has already have a transition to this crystal, then you put this packing mechanism to enhance the possibility to observe that transition, but the original model already has that transition without the packing.
Uh-huh.
And for that, you need the only interaction that you have, if I don't understand it wrong, is the exclusion mechanism.
Yes, so you have exclusion plus packing.
Yeah. So then, question is, if you, instead of having just this this interaction by exclusion, you have some sort of long-range interaction or that,
yes.
Do you still get this sort of mechanism of having a transition to this glass state?
In fact, this packing field can be seen as a long-range interaction. So if you have just WASEP, or even if you remove exclusion, but you have this long-range interaction, but it has to have this shape in the sense
if you have a tailored long-range interaction, which is this one that, which is an external field, which can also be poised as a sort of mean field, because external fields and mean fields
sort of the same, yeah.
But has to be tailored to observe that. It's not general, we will not get.
I think you have to tailor it in some way with this mechanism. In fact, there's some interesting paper in PRL. You know, there are a few no-go theorems for time crystals. No? So people realize after Vilcek proposed the idea that time crystal really cannot happen in equilibrium quantum systems. No? So in this case, we are going out of equilibrium because we have currents. No? But then people realize that there is a loophole in these no-go theorems if you allow for long-range interactions. This is like a PRL, I don't know if this year or last year. So they have open quantum system with long-range interaction. And in that case, if you allow for long-range interactions, then you may observe equilibrium time crystal-like phases in open quantum systems.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
More questions? Pablo, I didn't understand very well what is this Doob's transformation. You said you had to pay some a price. You convert your dynamics in something non-local in space, in time. Can you please elaborate? Because
let me go back somewhere. Okay. Oh, I went beyond. Sorry. Doob's. Where it is? Here. Okay. So you have this tilted generator. Okay, which is very simple to write down in terms of the original generator, because you are just biasing jumps to the right versus jumps to the left, no? To write down the Doob's generator, you need this L0 matrix, which is essentially related to the left eigenvalue. So just to start, to write down the Doob generator, you need to solve the spectral problem, which we don't know how to do that in general, no? In fact, this left eigenvalue contains all the information on the typical path of a given fluctuation. So all this traveling wave physics is encoded in this matrix here, L0. So when I was telling you about this complexity, is that all this traveling wave complexity is encoded in this L0, no? Okay, So the thing is that this looks already as a standard generator, but the problem is that the probability for this particle in my ring to jump to the left or to the right depends on where all other particles are. Yeah. And this dependence is not any dependence in principle. This dependence is encoded in this eigenvector. So the really funny technical thing of all this analysis is the realization that this Doob field, which is essentially the Doob dynamics, at the end of the day is a simple mechanism, this packing mechanism. So this is like the key, really key point. What I like most of this work, no, that I really do understand how the such a simple model is managing to pack particles without interactions, without any just diffusion, no. So all this complexity at the end of the day is just this thing that the system is packing particles with this sinus around the center of mass. It pushes particles behind the center of mass, and it drags particles which are in front of the center of mass. So it packs, and this allows to make the dynamic wave.
Okay, thank you. Are there more questions? If not, Pablo, thank you again. You are very kind.
Thank you for the invitation.
For a really nice talk.
It's a big pleasure to talk and to see you all. I hope everything is fine over there.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye. Say hello to everybody there. Bye.
Bye.
Hello, Cristóbal. Muchas gracias por todo.